Hello, my name is John Rose, and in this video I'd like to take a closer look at what I normally eat in a day. Now, I don't normally eat at this time of day, so I can't show you what I'm eating right now, but I can at least tell you what I normally eat. I'm going to start off by explaining my salad, because my salad will depend upon how active I am throughout the day, and then what else I eat depends upon what else, how active I am throughout the day. And my meals, I normally, my calorie range is usually from around 2,500 to 3,500. Because I'm still pretty active. If I'm really active, I might burn 5,000 calories a day, and then I'll probably eat around 3,500 to make sure I give my body everything it needs. I know how to eat and make sure I keep my carbohydrate fill tank full, because I perfected this mathematical procedure a long time ago, and I kept track of this for so long, I know pretty much exactly where my carbohydrate fill tank is and how much fruit I need to eat to keep that tank full. And I know from all the work I've done in the past that I can expend 5,000 calories and only eat about 3,500 calories and still have more carbohydrates than I need to fill up my carbohydrate fill tank. But I'm gonna start with the salad, because if I'm really active, I'll put more fat in my salad. And it's interesting how that skews all the numbers. Oh my God, look at the fat percentage. But then when you add it to everything else, wow, the fat comes right back down, doesn't it? So percentages are deceptive when you only look at what you're eating per meal. You gotta look at the big picture. So if I have a typical salad, my typical salad is about 3 pounds of greens and about 1 pound of tomatoes. And then I either add more fat to it, like an avocado with some sesame seeds, or I just have it the way that, I just have it real simple. So typical salad would be 1 pound of romaine lettuce, 1 pound of red leaf lettuce, 1/2 pound of kale, and 1/2 pound of celery. So those are the 3 pounds. Instead of saying a head of lettuce, you know, heads of lettuce can weigh over 2 pounds, 2.5 pounds, some can weigh 10 ounces. So medium size, small size, well, all that's relative too. So I always weigh everything, and sometimes a pound of romaine lettuce will be half a head, and sometimes it's not enough. You need a little bit more. But on an average, that's usually what my salads look like. So that's my base to my salad. Now, what do I do for a salad dressing? Well, I'll put some lime juice on there. And I like to put some fat. So if we look at just the numbers I gave you without any fat, the 3 pounds of greens and let's say 1 pound of tomatoes, that's going to run you right around 400 calories. You're going to get about 31 grams of protein, and that's going to be about 32% of your calories. And you can get a little over 5 grams of fat, which is plenty of fat for us just in this one meal alone that we'll need throughout the day, and that's about 13% fat. Remember, leafy greens are very high in fat, relatively speaking. So we get all of our good fats by eating a lot of greens every day. And as you can see, I'm getting 3 pounds of leafy greens right here, about 400 calories, 31 grams of protein. Now, if I add just a 4 ounce avocado, a small avocado to that, I'd bump up the calories by 200, up to close to 600 calories approximately. The protein now goes up to 33, so you're not getting a whole lot of protein when you eat an avocado because it's so high in fat. But then the fat goes from 13% all the way up to 39%, up to 24 grams of protein approximately. So we can see how the numbers are already being skewed. But then if I make a salad dressing, which I do many times, and what I do with my salad dressings are very simple and basic. I'll take 2 ounces of sesame seeds, unhulled, real important, because that right there is 687 grams of calcium. Unhulled calcium has 10 times the calcium as whole sesame seeds, so never buy anything processed like that. Always buy it whole. But you're also getting tons of protein, and you're getting some more calories and some more fat. So the salad now gets up to almost 900 calories, another 300 calories with those sesame seeds. The protein goes from that started out at 31 with the 33 is now 44 grams of protein, 19.5% protein now in this salad approximately. And then the fat goes from 39% up to 54%, 52 grams of fat now in this salad. And when we look at this 900 gram salad, you go, this 900 calorie salad, you go, oh my God, look at it, it's over half fat, it's no good. But when I add that into what I ate before the salads, which would be some fruit, and then the fruit I had for my first meal, we're looking at an overall fat percentage of maybe around 16%, provided I'm up around the 3,500 calorie range, which I am many times. So when I go for a 3,500 calorie day, I'm eating about a 900 calorie salad, the rest has to come from fruit. You do the math. Okay, how much fruit do I need to eat? 2,600 calories of fruit. Now, how much is that in In terms of fruit, depends what you're eating. 26 bananas, oh my God, that's a lot of bananas. Yeah, but I just burned 5,000 calories, my gosh. People who can't eat a lot of food probably don't exercise very much, because when you exercise a bunch, your appetite goes up big time, because your body knows, I'm real in tune to my body. In fact, if I don't exercise, I can't eat more than 6, maybe 9 bananas if I haven't done anything to earn those calories. I go out and bike for 3 hours and come back, man, I can pound down 15 bananas with a bunch of celery and strawberries into a huge, overfills my Vitamix. I have to pour it out and keep putting stuff in. But you know, I can get lots of calories very easily when you exercise. And again, you don't need that many calories unless you're exercising. So that would be the one extreme. What if I'm not exercising quite as much and I only need 2,500 instead of 3,500 calories? Well now, instead of 2,600 calories, I only need 1,600 calories. So now that would be like 16 bananas. So what I do is I split that, the fruit I need between my first meal and the second meal. I usually eat about half the amount of fruit I ate in the first meal. So I got 2 units here, 1 unit down here, right? So divide, take those 3 into the 16. Let's make it 15 to make the math easy. 500, well, 533, that's complicated, right? We'll use 500, right? So 1,000 calories in the first meal, 500 calories in the second meal that I add before my salad. So before I gorge myself on this huge monstrous salad, I eat some fruit, about half the amount of fruit I ate in the meal before. And if I'm not active at all, I won't eat anything at all before the fruit meal. So every day varies based on my activity and my appetite. And that's how I eat. I don't say, okay, I'm gonna sit down and eat this much food no matter what, because it does matter what. I can't eat a bunch of food if I don't earn the calories. Now, bananas are relatively high in calories. So if we switch to something like watermelon, oh my God, you gotta eat tons of watermelon to get that many calories. And of course, when you're eating, you know, something as water rich as watermelon, it's emptying your stomach about as fast as you're putting it in. So it's not as hard to do if you just take your time and eat and you get used to developing an appetite. Now, to illustrate another way how easy it'd be to get calories with foods that are even higher than the bananas, like persimmons, for example. In fact, the day I analyzed this, I went back and looked at a day I did a couple years ago. I've been documenting everything I've eaten for 30 years. I just don't push the numbers out anymore. I don't need to, but I have it there so I can always reference to it and say, well, what did I eat last year this time? What did I eat the year before? What did I eat 10 years ago on this day? And when did I do it? So I can analyze all that stuff, but I don't push the numbers out. But the type of salad I'm talking about right now was one I ate a couple years ago. It was later in the year when the persimmons were around, and all I had to do to get my 3,500 calories was to eat 6 7-ounce persimmons for my first meal and 3 7-ounce persimmons before I ate the salad. Persimmons are really high in calories. I'm sure this is probably why the Chinese believed it was a secret to longevity. Boy, it could get you through the times when there wasn't a lot of food, right? You don't need to eat very many persimmons to get your calories. Very high in calories. And of course, if we look at something like durian, which is relatively high in fat, 25-30% fat, you know, you can eat one durian and get 2,000 calories real easy. In fact, that's usually about how much durian I eat when I do it. I haven't done it in a while, but I do remember going through the calculations and going, yeah, it's another 2,000 calories from that durian right there alone. So what if I choose peaches? Oh my God. Again, plums, a lot of fruits don't have a lot of calories, and you gotta eat a ton of them to get your calories. So how do we make this work for the beginner who's not used to eating so much food? Well, that's where the juices come into play. And I finally broke down and did something this year that I've been wanting to do for decades, and I love it more than anything. And it's when I was drinking 3 liters of vegetable juice throughout the day and then 1 big fruit meal at night. And I loved it. It was the best ever. Except when the fruits came in, I couldn't resist wanting to eat more fruit. I just love mangoes when they come in season. In fact, I fasted earlier this year, and I was thinking that the mangoes would be coming in season right when I could break the fast, so I could have that as part of breaking my fast. And they just were horrible when that time came, so I ended up fasting a lot longer. And even then, when I finally broke the fast, there wasn't any good mangoes until finally, after I'd done this a while, and I go, okay, they're finally here. I got indulged because I love mangoes. Mangoes, they're about as many calories as grapes, close to them. Grapes, about 2 pounds of grapes would be about 700 calories. So divide 7 into 26, and you can figure out how many pounds of grapes you need to eat. So people keep asking me, you know, how much do I need to eat? Well, you know, you can go to websites, Chronometers and Fit Day. You can punch all that stuff in, and I always tell my students to do that. Punch your numbers in, and it'll tell you what you're getting, and you can see what it's going to take to make this work. You can see, oh my God, I only got 1,300 calories. I need 2,100 calories or 3,200 calories. And then how do I get them? Well, let me push some. How much fruit do I need to eat? Well, play with it. Put the numbers in. Everyone's different. Everyone likes different food. When it comes to the details in what to eat like this and what to juice, my approach is different than anyone else. And I know it drives some of you guys crazy because all you want to know is, tell me what it is, John. Tell me what. I got a small cup. Tell me what. I understand personalities are different. And I understand what you're asking me for. What do I do? You got to do this and this and this. Oh, I don't like those. Tell me something else. That's why I like to be more flexible in my approach. My approach is, look, we got to figure out the basic ballpark calorie number we need to eat. And then we know by default, if we get that calorie number, everything else will work the way it should, provided we keep certain numbers in the right area, especially those carbohydrate calories. We have to keep our carbohydrate fuel tank full. That's the foods we're designed to eat. We got a very small carbohydrate fuel tank. Ideally, every time we eat, we want to top that fuel tank off. So what if I don't do anything all day long? I don't need that many carbohydrates. How many carbohydrates does it take to fill up my fuel tank? Not that many. 6 bananas, in most cases, will fill up most people's fuel tanks if they haven't done anything and they ate properly the right way the day before. But then that doesn't address total calories. The carbohydrate calories we need are about 40% of our calories at rest. We're burning a lot of fat throughout the day, so that means we can eat a lot more calories than just the minimal amount to fill up our carbohydrate fuel tank. And I've explained how to calculate all of this in one of my other videos. And gosh, what did I call that video? Ideal weight, calories and juices, maybe? I think that's what I called it. I'll be sure and put that down below in the description box as one of the links you can go to make sure you can find that easily. And I explained to you guys how to calculate the amount of calories you need at rest. To that, we add our activity. And again, if you just go to some of these websites, you can put this detailed information in and it can help you understand how much extra you're burning. A lot of them just use basic formula saying, you know, give us your activity level, and it kind of gives you a general idea of how many calories you need to burn. But if you want the detailed information, you can figure it out. And I know a lot of you don't want to put any time in any of this. You don't even want to know why. I already know why. Don't tell me why. Just tell me what. Again, I'm a why guy, and I'm going to do that in my videos, and I'm really glad that you're motivated to do this. That's what you got to do. I know you're wanting detailed information. Tell me exactly what I got to do at this time, and I don't do that. I'm not going to do that. Now I'm telling you what to do, and I don't do that. I give you guidelines, basic guidelines to go by. I give people the calories and juices and fruits and vegetables, and I'll have that up on my website up and running pretty quick. There's so much I need to do, and I want to give special thanks to all you guys out there that are helping me on my channel. I see what y'all are doing, and man, unbelievable. Really gives me a lot of confidence that we can actually make a difference. There's enough people out there in this movement if we can just get us organized and start contributing and adding all this stuff together. I've never seen us ever get organized. There's a lack of continuity in this movement, that we bicker about how much fruit to eat and how much fat we eat. We got to get past that and figure out how to offer a unified message to the masses. And I want to promote anybody who says we should correct any one of these 5 mistakes. But don't you dare say the first mistake is not a mistake, because that's the only mistake we need to correct. Because if we don't make the first mistake, guess what happens? We don't make the second mistake. We don't eat the animals. We don't make the third mistake. We don't eat grains. And yet I still have idiots out there saying, oh, but McDougal's got all this scientific evidence that proves what he's doing work. What do you got? What scientific evidence do you got? Give me a break. All of his evidence is comparing a plant-based diet to a shit diet. Every diet's better than that diet. What does that tell us? It tells us that we can rate our diets on a scale of 1 to 10. Well, 1's the worst and 10's the best. If you're at a 1 or a 3 and you come up to a 5 or a 6 or a 7, voila, look at all the problems that went away. Why settle? Go to number 10. That's a raw vegan diet. It's very hard for most of us to do. If this is the first video you've ever seen, go down to the description box below, and I have a seminar on how to do the first of a 3-step process, which is the best transition into a raw vegan diet. If you're on a raw vegan diet right now, periodic fasting is part of what we need to do. So we need to do this every now and then. And if you're on a juice fast and you're having trouble and things aren't working, if you're still having symptoms and you've done everything you could to support your organs of elimination and your body in the best way you can, and you're still having problems, stop, stop, stop. You cleanse as fast as your body will allow you. If you do the juices and you support your organs of elimination, and you support every part of the body you know that's damaged and you're helping it, and you're having problems, stop it, you're cleansing too quickly. You gotta slow it down. Now we gotta, instead of, if we can't support the organs of elimination, then what we have to do is slow down the rate at which we're cleansing. We gotta slow it down. Now, this can get really complicated because some of us are so toxic we can't assimilate anything. So if we can't assimilate anything, what do? We gotta stop eating. Either a water fast or a juice fast. So the problem with water fasting is most people don't know anything about it, just like they don't know about juice fasting either, but they're not afraid of juices, they're afraid of starving, and that's what most people think about. Even natural hygienists know the first rule of fasting is you can't have fear and fasting combined. You can't fear the fast, and most people do. Well, that doesn't mean we can't educate them and get them to do it. I agree. But we're not going to get enough people to reach the tipping point with a water fast. That's why we have to come together and offer a unified message and stop poo-pooing the one thing that's going to get us to the tipping point. So many of us are short-sighted. Short-sighted. Doug Graham, Lauren Lockwood, this idiot at Master Fast, putting people on dead food that doesn't have any biophotons in it, thinking that's going to be a solution because it can cleanse the body. And what's he doing? He's giving you what you want, isn't he? Here, do this, do this, do this. It's not hard. Buy this processed bottle crap. No biophotons. Make this concoction. No biophotons. Will it clean you out? Yeah. So will water fasting. No biophotons. You see the superiority to juice fasting. Nothing can bump up your biophotons like juice fasting. Dr. Pop says it bumps them up to 114,000. So ideally, that's how we want to change. We change as fast as our body will allow us. Most of us can do a juice fast. If you're doing it and things aren't working and you can't support those organs of elimination, if the kidneys aren't filtering, stop it, stop it, stop it. And one of the first things I do when I work with someone, I said, look, before you can do a juice cleanse, we got to make sure your kidneys are working. Are you urinating? See, the kidneys still have to process juices. So if they're not up to the task, then we can't go that direction. What they could do is a water fast or even the master cleanser using distilled water. So that's what I usually do with people in the beginning is I say, look, the distilled water will actually cleanse the kidneys and maybe that might help. Of course, there's a lot of other things we can do to break up stones that we might have that are causing the problems. And of course, if the kidneys aren't filtering, we know we got to go to the adrenals. So this can take time. So we always change as fast as our body will allow us. We try the juices. If the adrenals are down, we can't cleanse as fast as we want. So hopefully you can assimilate what you eat. And if you can't, then you're gonna have to go to something like a water fast or the master cleanser or this other whatever product this guy calls his program. I've only glanced at it and had several people mention that he's poo-pooing juice fasting. Well, he's like Lauren and Doug. It's money, money, money. Oh, shame on you guys trying to say juice fasting is not any good because you want them to do your protocol. Screw you people, man. Not enough people are going to do a water fast, and the other program is too limited. You're not addressing the issues of deficiency. You're not addressing the biophotons with just doing a master cleanser and some pasteurized dead food you buy off a shelf. I don't care if it cleans you out or not. It's dead food, fool. We gotta stop killing our food. Number one, If we don't stop killing our food, everything else is a distraction. This clown on the internet that's saying juice fasting is bad is a distraction, because he's poo-pooing the only thing that's going to get us to reach the tipping point. You see what I'm saying? So I'm not saying don't do his protocol. For some of us, that's the only thing you're going to do. Hey, if more people do that and they finally do something else, they change their diet, yippee, great. But don't slam raw food, don't slam juice fasting, because you're too short-sighted. You don't understand the big picture. You got to understand that if we don't reach the tipping point, things are never going to change. We've got to adopt a raw vegan diet. What's it going to take for you to make that happen? Well, most of us just can't go from where we're at to where we need to be. The best transition is a juice fast. Go down below, watch the Deborah Duncan Show, listen to Dr. Roba, go to my seminar, I'll tell you how to do it if you haven't done it. Look at the comments, we have a lot of people doing it right now. They're just finishing up. Great, I've got great commenters on my message board. They're sharing their experience, they're contributing. In so many ways, it's amazing. If we all keep doing what we're doing, it won't take long before we can gain some momentum and wake everybody up. So do everything you can to promote raw veganism and juice fasting. And remember, we all appeal to different people. We all have different personalities. We're gonna have strengths to appeal to other people. And obviously you wanna try to your best to appeal to other people that are perceiving reality different than you. They have different personalities. But we all wanna get out there and get our message, because there are ways that you're gonna present this information that's different than me, and you're going to appeal to people who are different than me. So I'm glad there are other people out there doing things differently. Respect the way I do things. I appreciate your feedback, but I'm not this person, I'm not that person, I'm me. I'm a why guy. I got to be me. I got to appeal to the largest group of people who's going to want to follow me, and that's other why people. But I want all the what's and the who's and the hows to come along too. And I give the hows tons of information, the details. The who's, well, to help those guys, they're just part of the community. The what's are the ones who are impatient and they want the information now. They don't want to know the whys. They don't even, all they want to do is tell me what to do, John. Well, I'm telling you what to do. You got to put a little bit of effort into it to figure out how to customize it for you. If you want me to customize it, give me a call and put me to work. I need to, how do I want to say this? I need as many of you guys to support me in every way you can. And the main way you can support me is doing exactly what you're doing right now. That's all you need to do, is keep commenting, keep contributing, and I don't mind feedback saying, I wish you could be more like so-and-so. I'm not so-and-so. I'm not gonna do what they do. That's not me. And I know I'm ranting right now. but anyway, the main thing that matters is for us to play our role. And a big part of that is sharing this message. So keep liking my videos, even if you don't like the one you're watching. comment, by all means comment. Subscribe if you haven't subscribed. Share the message. And I don't ask people to do that very often. But you can tell I'm very passionate about what I do. I want this message to get out to the masses. I want us to get along and not say we shouldn't do this and we shouldn't do this. And there are a lot of people who do different things and they're saying we shouldn't do what I'm promoting. And nothing that they're doing is going to get enough people's attention. So let's be realistic about all of this. Let's realize that things are never going to change unless we reach the tipping point. There's a reason why we've got to really play an active role in this hero's journey. Once you find out for yourself that you can solve your own problems, you're going to want to find a purpose for why you suffered. And the only way to make any meaning out of the suffering that most of us have, because that's how we found this way of life, because we were suffering, the system didn't offer us a solution. We found a raw vegan diet, it solved our problem. The only way to find true meaning out of that experience is to find people that went through exactly what you went through. That's why we all appeal to different people in our own way. So what you need to do, if you have these problems and we're suffering from these situations, then you can relate to people in those similar situations, and that's how you can make some meaning out of your life, by turning that suffering into an opportunity to help other people in that suffering. So get excited about this message. Start up YouTube channels. Keep doing what you're doing. Keep contributing. Keep commenting. Keep helping other people, because I can't answer everybody's questions. I'm really quite overwhelmed right now because I'm putting up a video every day. I've got tons of comments. I'm falling behind on reading everybody's comments. I'm doing the best I can. A lot of you guys are asking me a lot of questions that it's going to take me too long to type it out. I'm sorry. I'll try to cover some of those topics, as I mentioned, in the following videos. The biggest comment I'm getting from dozens and dozens and dozens and dozens of people is, John, you're just too complicated. And so I'm not just replying to one person with that video I did the other day. I've got dozens of people who keep saying, John, you're too complicated. And I agree, it does appear that way in the beginning. But read these comments and you're going to find that once you bump up those biphotons, once you take a look at it a little bit closer, you're going to find that it makes everything easier. And it's going to help you think and respond better. I was watching a video the other day of one of my students when he was being interviewed, and I could see his brain working using the three stages of knowledge as he communicated his ideas to make sure the other people understood what they're saying. So it's important to understand these three stages of knowledge, just like it's important to understand that we have to give ourselves a solid food vacation, and we've got to stop making five main mistakes. And when we do all of that, then we're in for a treat.